Believe it.
Yeah.
If you said it. what you say.
The roar of heaven begin. Can
No.
You ready?
Well, good morning, everyone. So great to have you with us, especially if you're new. Welcome to Vintage. My name's Ash. I'm the associate pastor here. In a moment, our guest speaker, the one, the only, Kathleen Doyle, is going to come and speak to us. We're on week three of our new series, Proverbs, Wisdom for LA Life. We're looking forward to that. But before all of this, we're going to worship and pray. So why don't you join me? Let's still our hearts. Let's welcome the Lord into our morning together. Father, we thank you for your faithfulness. We thank you for your goodness. We thank you for your love and for your presence, for you are a good God. And now, Lord, we invite you, would you fill us with your Holy Spirit as we worship you now? We pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Let's worship the Lord.
Stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows. You win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. Yeah. So when I fight, mighty fortress. An almighty fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows, you win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. Oh, an almighty fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows, you win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. Oh, the power of our God. Oh, no one stands between us. The power of our God. No one else. Oh, the power of our God. So we sing, Christ alone. Savior's love through the storm. He is Lord, Lord of all. You are Christ alone now. Oh, in Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior. In Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong, in the Savior's love, and through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all.
So Father, as we pray to you now, we surrender to Christ alone. We worship Christ alone. We put our faith and our trust in Christ alone. We know that through your love, any weakness that we find ourselves struggling with, any storm that we find ourselves in the midst of, that you can be with us. And so we praise you and we thank you for that reality, that you are a God who is faithful and with his people. And let's take a moment right now just to pray for anyone we know, even if it's ourselves, who are in the midst of a storm, facing difficult circumstances in whatever way. And so, Lord, we do pray for those for whom we know and love, who are in the midst of a storm. Jesus, we pray that you would be in their line of sight, that you would be their focus, that they would be able to surrender to you irrespective of what is going on around them. And we pray for your presence. We pray for your peace. And we pray for your transformative love to be with them right now. And And so just take a moment to name anybody in those circumstances, anyone you want to pray for right now. Lift them before the Lord, praying that they might meet with Him afresh. And so, Lord, we name those we love and know. We name them before You, knowing that You see them and You know them. We pray that You would meet with them. We pray this in Your mighty name. Amen. Well, again, a very, very warm welcome to Vintage Church. So great to have you with us. This week, our Alpha course and our Financial Peace courses have just begun. So there's still an opportunity to jump into those courses. They're online, so you can find out details on our website. At 12:30 today, we have our New to Vintage Zoom. So if you're new or you feel new and you haven't been to one of these, we'd love to invite you to join us online for our New to Vintage Zoom. All the information for these and lots of other ways to jump into the life of our church can be found on our website at vintagechurchla.com. Now, recently, our senior pastor, Gare Jones, caught up with our former worship pastor, Brenton Brown, to find out what's going on in their lives. Watch this. They're going to give us an update.
So it is brilliant to be on the phone with you or Zoom with you, Brenton. We love you guys. And of course, you were for many years arm in arm with us, the worship pastor and your family. We love you dearly. But obviously, the last few years have been through, you've been through so much with the fires and losing your house in Malibu and the COVID hit and all sorts of things. And so we wanted to check in, just get an update from you guys and just say, how are you?
Well, we're still alive. Which is an achievement in itself. Yeah, we're doing good. It's been a roller coaster, basically, with the fires and then, the pandemic, another natural disaster that no one is exempt from. So we're all going through it. But a year ago we thought we were going to rebuild. Had a couple things to do. Moved back onto the land in some trailers. And expected to break ground and get going. And then shortly after that, COVID hit. Administrative hoops started to increase. And eventually, after living there for 6 months, just for the sake of my sweet family, we decided we need to decamp. We're out of there. Displacement insurance, but we were still living in trailers. And I was like, man, if ever there was a time to take care of your family with savings, this is the time. So we have friends in Nashville and we decamped to Nashville, and we've been here since Thanksgiving of 2020. And it's going good. It's a lot better for our family. Really much needed stability.
Yeah, man, our hearts have been with you. We can't imagine all that you've been faced with, the Malibu fires, losing your home, all that stuff to rebuild. And then seems like moving to Nashville was such a blessing for you and the family. And we just want to say, man, we miss you. We love you guys. And we are so thankful for all that you have done in our community to just foster that amazing DNA of spirit-led worship and a hunger for the Lord and His presence. And we hope when all this is over and when you come back, we can see you again and have you lead here. But how can we pray for you and the family in this season as you're in Nashville for the foreseeable future? How can we pray for you and help you?
I'm just pray when you think of us, just pray for us just as we settle in and get used to it. But we've definitely felt the prayers, and we feel the same reciprocal gratitude. It was a wonderful season at Vintage, and just so many great memories. And there's not a week that goes by that I don't have a text or text somebody from church and just see and find out how they're doing. So, sad. I mean, it's crazy to think that a year ago, I was super tired. You and I would have our meetings, and I go, you go, how you doing, Brown? I'd be like, I'm feeling quite tired, Jones. And then eventually I was like, man, actually, I'm at the point where I need to stop. So I took a month off. You know, the doctor was like, take a month off and see how you go. And at the end of it, I was like, I'm still really tired. So I stepped back from ministry, which wasn't my first choice, but it's just, it's part of the journey, I guess, that we're on. And it has been good to be able to have time with the family, especially as we go through all these tumultuous changes. It's been really, really good. So, yeah, so we're out here and I'm writing songs. Girls are going to school. Jude has friends out here, so it's sweet. And I just wanted to say just a massive thank you to the Vintage community and to you and Lizzie for an incredible season. Just so many special times in the presence of the Lord. I surely do miss that. I'm sure everybody does. But very grateful.
Well, we love you, man. And you said we were catching up beforehand. And just tell us a bit about the significance of the room you're in right now.
Yeah, it's pretty strange, man. So when I was a kid, just before I went to Oxford to study from South Africa, I did a little 6-week mini tour of the United States of America. And I stopped in at all the music towns and I stayed over at a dentist in Nashville. And he said, I've got a buddy who does engineering. Would you like to go to see a studio? I think they're recording something. So I went, yeah, I'd love it. Like, I'd love to show me whatever you have. And I went to this studio. The guy was amazing. Gave me a book on classic Christianity and showed me some mics. It was everything a young worship leader could dream of. And then I went to England for 7 years, longer than that. And then when we moved for the first time to the States, I recorded a record called Everlasting God. And it was actually in this studio that I recorded that record. And now, just purely coincidentally, just by the providence of God, my office, my little studio is exactly that same room where I first visited a music studio in America and then when I recorded Everlasting God. So, yeah.
Well, I don't think there's a more important message still to sing, is there, in this season than right. You are the Everlasting God. Yeah. And you don't fail. So, hey, man, we love you and stay in touch. We're praying for you and the family out in Nashville. We want to say thank you so much for all that you did to invest in our community and be partnering and building it together, particularly around the hunger for the presence of God. So, man, much love to you, and we can't wait to see you again one day soon.
Yeah, much love. Massive privilege for us. God bless you guys.
God bless you, mate.
It's good to be with you, Vintage. We are continuing our series in Proverbs, and we will be talking specifically in the chapter of Proverbs chapter 3. So if you want to turn there, that would be great. We're going to go through the whole thing, but I want to do a little bit of setup and just frame this up a bit. I think for all of us, I know it's been said so many times, but this year has felt so complicated, stressful, overwhelming, and just not very fun. And I think it was a real eye-opener of the need, as I looked at Scripture, as I looked at what was going on in my life, a need for wisdom, a need to really turn to God in terms of His counsel, His guidance, and the way that He would call me to live. Because to be really frank, spiritually, I felt really dried out. I don't know about you. I felt like my prayers felt like they were hitting the ceiling, and I wasn't seeing a lot of movement. I wasn't seeing a lot of things happening. And so I had a moment where I felt like the Lord really said, just come back to my word and start applying it. Don't worry about the supernatural today. Today, I want you to worry about just understanding who I am and walking in my ways. And that is the counsel of Proverbs. It's the counsel of all of the wisdom literature. And one of the interesting things about the wisdom literature, and Gare had spoken and done a really great frame up a few weeks ago. If you missed that, it'd be great to go back and listen to that. But the counsel in the book of Proverbs, Ecclesiastes, Lamentations, etc., it's a really honest view of the world. And it's a really clear sense that this place after the fall became very complicated, and navigating it can be really, really difficult. And this is where we get to turn to Scripture and go, what do I do in the everyday living when things get really, really messy? What are you calling me to? How am I supposed to navigate this place? And so as we look specifically at chapter 3, what we're going to see in Proverbs is that you're going to begin to hear two important themes that are going to go throughout the book. One is that there is a path, and there are over 700 references in Scripture about a path. And in the book of Proverbs, you're going to hear the path of foolishness or folly and the path of wisdom. And on each of them, they describe it metaphorically as this woman, the lady folly and the lady wisdom, is inviting you on her path. And the path of folly or foolishness is a path that leads to ruin and destruction and death. The path of wisdom is a path that leads to righteousness and life and flourishing and goodness. And there's this acknowledgement that as human beings, as we walk this earth, we are going to come to a lot of different points where we're going to have to choose one of these. This isn't something that the Lord does for us. This is something that we have to step into. It's something that we're invited into. The other thing that you're going to see is this reference to, in chapter 3, the tree of life. And what that's designed to do is to be a contrast, and it's designed to be a foil to the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. When we go back to the original creation and we go back to the fall, all of a sudden human beings were exposed and aware of evil. I don't think we were designed to ever know what that was about. I don't think that we're wired to handle it well. I don't think obviously it doesn't do anything to help us, but it's nothing that we cope with very well. So when we're hit with the knowledge of evil, which I think we felt very hit with this last year, that is a place of chaos and it's a place of confusion. And from that place of chaos and confusion, we can start really spinning out of control. We can start grabbing towards some really unhealthy things to try to cope with that. And what we see in this book of Proverbs is this invitation toward the tree of life. Follow this counsel. In the midst of the storm, when you cannot see the path in front of you, when you cannot get clarity, step on this road. If you've ever gone hiking on rugged terrain or been out in the middle of the ocean, you know it's so important to be prepared, and it's so important to be ready with good tools to navigate that. Because if a storm comes in, if something goes wrong, you don't want to be figuring it out at the moment. You want to be prepared. And so the book of Proverbs is this preparation, and it's this invitation into the wise path. It's this invitation into some sort of peace and guidance in the midst of the storm. And so if we look at Proverbs chapter 3, I'm going to read the whole thing. I had debated maybe editing it, but the whole point of this chapter is to really consider the whole counsel of Scripture. Tim Keller refers to this chapter as a summary of the entire book of Proverbs. And when we look at chapter 3, what we've been tempted to do, you're going to hear a lot of passages in here that we have on, you know, bumper stickers. We don't do that anymore, do we? We don't do bumper stickers anymore. But, you know, that we have on magnets or whatever else. You know, these are little things that people have pulled out, but it's really not designed to be pulled out of context. This counsel is meant to be kept together. And as this counsel stays together, we find the kind of the flourishing and the hopes that go along with this. So it begins in verse 1, chapter 3, "My child, never forget the things I've taught you. Store my commands in your heart. If you do this, you will live many years and your life will be satisfying. Never let loyalty and kindness leave you. Tie them around your neck as a reminder. Write them deep within your heart. Then you will find favor with both God and people, and you'll earn a good reputation. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and do not depend on your own understanding. Seek his will in all you do, and he will show you which path to take. Don't be impressed by your own wisdom. Instead, fear the Lord and turn away from evil. Then you will have healing for your body and strength for your bones. Honor the Lord with your wealth and with the best part of everything you produce. Then he will fill your barns with grain and your vats will overflow with good wine. My child, do not reject the Lord's discipline, and don't be upset when he corrects you. For the Lord corrects those he loves, just as a father corrects a child in whom he delights. Joyful is the person who finds wisdom, the one who gains understanding. For wisdom is more profitable than silver, and her wages are better than gold. Wisdom is more precious than rubies, and nothing you desire can compare with her. She offers you long life in her right hand and riches and honor in her left. She will guide you down delightful paths. All her ways are satisfying. Wisdom is a tree of life to those who embrace her. Happy are those who hold her tightly. By wisdom, the Lord founded the earth. By understanding, he created the heavens. By his knowledge, the deep fountains of the earth burst forth, and the dew settles beneath the night sky. My child, don't lose sight of common sense and discernment. Hang on to them, for they will refresh your soul. They are like jewels on a necklace. They keep you safe on your way, and your feet will never stumble. You can go to bed without fear. You will lie down and sleep soundly. You need not be afraid of disaster or the destruction that comes upon the wicked, for the Lord is your security, and he will keep your feet from being caught in a trap. Do not withhold good from those who deserve it when it is in your power to help them. If you can help your neighbor now, don't say, come back tomorrow, and then I'll help you. Don't plot harm against your neighbor, for those who live nearby trust you. Don't pick a fight without reason when no one has done you harm. Don't envy violent people or copy their ways. Such wicked people are detestable to the Lord, and he offers his friendship to the godly. The Lord curses the house of the wicked, but he blesses the home of the upright. The Lord mocks the mockers, but is gracious to the humble. And so there is a lot of rich goodness in this passage. I want to unpack a little bit of it. But just keep bearing in mind, as I'm going to pick out some bits and pieces, it's really designed to be kept as a whole. And so one of the things I want to point out is sometimes we get this idea, if we go back, for example, to verse, where is it? 9, honor the Lord with your wealth and with the best part of everything you produce. Now, obviously, and that your barns will be full and your vats will be overflowing. And obviously, we want to honor the Lord with our wealth, but often I've seen that passage, for example, taken out of all the rest of the context. And so what we can do is compartmentalize and say, okay, I'm gonna tithe, right? And so now that I've tithed, I expect the Lord to provide for me and give me a nice big return on my investment. But the reality is, when you look at that whole passage, there's a whole lifestyle that complements this idea of generosity and of putting God first. It's a lifestyle that says people matter. It's a lifestyle of integrity. It's a lifestyle of honesty. And so not only will there be times where I think the Lord can miraculously bless us and decide to kind of give us a windfall if apparently we might need it, but at the same time, the life that you've lived, the business that you've conducted with integrity, the relationships that you've handled with respect and with kindness and generosity will all be part of the life that you're building. It's part of the path that you're walking on. And so these aren't really designed to be taken out and just say, Lord, I want a spiritual blessing out of you. Give it to me. I've paid you my 10%. Give me my return. It's really designed to say, wow, you've given me great counsel. And in addition to being generous to you, Lord, I want to be generous to the people around me. So it's really important, even as we unpack this, that we keep in mind this is meant to be carried as a whole. So we go back to the verses of 3 and 4. It says, never let loyalty and kindness leave you. Then you will find favor with both God and people, and you will earn a good reputation. And so this isn't a path that always has an immediate win. It's not that everything I do is going to have an immediate reward, but this is a long game kind of path. This is the steady and the enduring. It's a way of treating people. It's a way of interacting in the world that reaps a harvest of goodness. Doesn't mean everybody's going to return respect. It doesn't mean everybody's going to return friendship. But as I conduct myself with wisdom and I follow the counsel that the Lord's given me, in many cases, over time, you will see a harvest that comes from that is really rich. And so we're really encouraged in verse 5, trust the Lord with all your heart and do not depend on your own understanding. Seek his will in all you do, and he will show you which path to take. Don't be impressed with your own wisdom. Instead, fear the Lord and turn away from evil. And so what we see in here is a little bit of a letting go of our plans. if we are left to our own devices, especially when times are chaotic and especially when we are under stress, it's very easy to go to a highly self-preserving mode. My only job right now is to take care of me and to look out for me and not worry about anybody else. I feel stressed. I feel anxious. Nobody else is my problem. I'm just here to make sure I'm okay. And so what did we see this last year as a lot of people stepped into that mindset? We saw America run out of toilet paper. I mean, it was crazy, right? Right? I mean, it was just crazy. People couldn't think beyond themselves. And we, in addition to the chaos that already was upon us, we added to the chaos. We weren't measured in our responses. We weren't cautious in going, there's a whole community to look out for. And so we kind of went straight after what we thought would make us feel better and what would sort of cure our ails. And so what we want to do is remember, sometimes the counsel of Scripture is going to say, I know the temptation that you're going to have right now is to take care of yourself and only yourself. But wisdom requires the courage to think longer road, bigger picture, beyond just me. And so what it requires is humble courage. And so even what we have to recognize sometimes is that is an honest assessment. Proverbs is often a mirror that I'm supposed to put up to myself to reflect a bit and ask myself, what am I doing and what am I thinking? And so an honest assessment is I can go to self-preservation. I can go to my plans and not ask for any other wisdom. I can go off of straight instinct and intuition. And that isn't always going to get me ahead. And we see this need sometimes to lay down my plans, challenge my wisdom, reflect on whether or not I'm really approaching this biblically, and let the Lord speak over this in me. It's interesting. If you look at the 12-step program for addiction recovery, specifically if you look at AA's, the first one is the admission. It says, we admitted we were powerless over alcohol and that our lives had become unmanageable. The second step is we came to believe that a power greater than ourselves could restore our sanity. The first step to addiction recovery is humility. And there's few things more powerful than addiction. But what someone gets to is they finally get to a place where they say, I'm not going to continue to follow my strategy. Because when someone's addicted to alcohol, often what they experience is a sense that my feelings are intolerable. My scenario around me is overwhelming, and so I need to find something to numb myself out. And this feels really helpful and really good. And so what can happen is I can continue to go to that sort of substance over and over and over again to try to make myself feel better while my life falls further and further into chaos. And so in this step of humility, what someone says is it's gotten out of control, and I actually need other counsel now. And I'm closing the door on allowing myself to go in this direction for today. And I'm going to open the door to new counsel. I'm going to open the door to new ways to manage stress, pain, insecurity, whatever else might be happening. Now, I'm saying this partly because I think a lot of us decided that we were going to find something to numb us out this year. It was just overwhelming, and there may come a point where we have to lay that thing back down and say, Lord, let me pick up your counsel. What do you have for me? Because I've been trying to make myself feel better by checking out, but it's not really going to work. I can't just withdraw from the world. Wisdom and God's counsel makes us courageous. It says you can step back into this. Let me guide you. Let me show you how to step back into this. Take the risk to do it my way and see where that lands us. So what we want to do is really pay attention to how the Lord instructs us. And so what we can see here is, let me look at this. Sorry, I just lost my spot. Oh. What we see here, if we go down to verse 21, is that in this, sometimes what we can do as Christians, I don't want to speak for you, I can speak for myself, I can speak for some of the tradition I've been around, is this desire to sort of make everything supernatural. And this desire to make everything kind of extra because the Lord's in it. And what we see here in verse 21 is this call when we're not seeing the supernatural happen, is to lean on the wisdom that God has given us. It says, my child, do not lose sight of common sense and discernment. Hang on to them. They will refresh your soul. They will keep you safe on your way, and your foot will not stumble. You can go to bed without fear. You can sleep soundly. You will not need to be afraid of sudden disaster or destruction. For the Lord is your security, and he will keep your foot from being caught in a trap. What he's saying is, come, and as we look at the next several verses, we're going to see some of what this looks like, but rest in what I've told you. Trust in what I've said. It was interesting. I was just in a plane the other day, and unexpectedly, this big storm came in, which was something else. And it was interesting to hear the pilot say, this is why we've learned instrument ratings. This is why we've had to learn how to use these instruments, because we were literally flying in the dark. I mean, it was completely unclear what was in front of us. But this person had spent hours and hours and hours, hopefully thousands of hours, learning how to use this technology. And so even though we couldn't see where we were going, this technology kept us on a steady pace until we got through the clouds, until we got to a safe place. And so what we see right away in this scripture, some of the first counsel that we get is how to treat other people. We're told, love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, and mind. Love your neighbor as yourself. And being loving and wise and thoughtful and generous to our neighbors is some of the best counsel that we can have. But what we're invited to in the book of Proverbs isn't just to read it and go, oh, that sounds really nice. We're really invited to mull this over, think deeply about it, meditate on it, and consider how this really works itself out in life. What does this actually look like? Am I engaged in this? Am I doing this? Do I hold these attitudes that Scripture is calling me to hold, or do I actually believe and act in a completely different way? Proverbs, I love it because Tim Keller, he says it's like hard candy. You can take a piece of hard candy and crunch on it, and it has lost its purpose. What you're really supposed to do is just let that thing kind of hang out for a long time and do its work, especially if it's, you know, cough drops, right? And so, or you have bad breath. Either way, but what we want to do is really let that sit, and we need to think it through. Proverbs isn't meant to be, I read it, I'm done. It's meant to be, I read it, and I'm reflecting on it. I'm really thinking about it. So it says in verse 28, if you can help your neighbor now, don't say come back tomorrow, and then I'll help you. Don't plot harm against your neighbor. For those who live nearby you trust you, and don't pick a fight without reason. Don't envy violent people or copy their ways. Why is the scripture in here? Because when the knowledge of good and evil came, and all of a sudden we're living in a world of wheat and tares, we're living in a complicated world where there's temptation. Now, all of a sudden, these are things, if I'm not thoughtful about it, I can start engaging in it. I can deny goodness to people. I can deny help. I can deny justice. And God, in his goodness, is saying, Kathleen, I want better for you than that. Don't wipe out the toilet paper for the rest of America. Do better, right? And so in doing better and in engaging in the wisdom God's given us, one, it settles us, gives us some guidance. I've got a compass now. I've got a navigation system. I at least have a direction I'm going in. But it also makes us what God had called us to be, and that's blessed to be a blessing, a city on a hill, something that provides wisdom, clarity, hope, love, steadiness, peace in a world that has spun out of control. I know multiple times, several Proverbs went through my mind this year as we dealt with, I don't know if you know, there was an election. It was so exciting. And there were several Proverbs over and over, and I'm a debater. I did not grow up in the church. I grew up with science and politics. So keeping my mouth shut was not a piece of cake. And what I had to go back to, and I'm not kidding when I say these came to my mind over and over again, Proverbs 15:1, a gentle answer turns away wrath, but a harsh word stirs up anger. I had to think about that so many times. And hope to apply it. Proverbs 25:15, through patience, a ruler can be persuaded, and a gentle tongue can break a bone. That while I could just come at some argument or some person with harshness, being gentle, taking time, understanding, being respectful was going to be much more effective. An offended friend is harder to win back than a fortified city. Arguments separate friends like a gate locked with bars. I absolutely did not apply this scripture perfectly, but I did learn to recall it, and it steadied me at moments when I wanted to act out. So in the book of Proverbs, we're invited, reflect on these words. Let them steady you and give you courage in the chaos. Look at how you interact with these things. How do you measure up? Look at the people around you. How are they measuring up? And invite the Lord through his Holy Spirit to bring something richer and deeper into our lives and into our well-being. What I want to do is have Ash come up. We're just going to spend some time inviting you to bring some of this to the Lord for yourself and in your own life, and ask him to do a work in us individually, but as a community, that we would reflect the wisdom of God and reflect the courage that he gives us because of his wisdom. So Ash, if you want to come up.
Let's take a moment right now. Can I invite you wherever you are? If you can, close your eyes, as long as you're not walking the streets listening to this. If you're at home, in bed, in a house with others, take a moment. Let's close our eyes. Let's just recognize right now. Maybe for some of us, we already know where we have responded to the circumstances of the last year, the last few months, and we've reached out for self-securing projects, for self-preservation, for medicating, for taking control back. And I think God's invitation to us this morning is that powerful metaphor of him being the pilot of our lives, and to trust him afresh. Trust in the Lord with all of your heart. So just take a moment right now. Reflect on the places where perhaps you have taken back control, where perhaps out of unhealthy reaction, you have grabbed hold of something that's not of the Lord. He knows, and he knows you know. And his invitation to us right now is to let go, the humble courage to let go and take a trust fall back into the Lord. Father, I pray for anyone this morning for whom this message has hit the target, for whom they know that they know this is an opportunity, a window of grace to fall back into trusting you with all of our heart. Help us to let go of those places where we have taken back control, depended on ourselves, medicated, helped ourselves with the wrong things. We invite you, Lord, to reveal to us afresh your grace and your love. We invite you afresh to be the pilot of our lives. So as we worship you now, we surrender those places. Can I invite you, if you are doing business with God, stay in that place as we worship. Go through a process of re-surrendering. And then ask the Lord to speak to you. And I pray this in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen.
carried a burden for too long on my own, and I wasn't created to bear it alone. I hear your invitation to let it all go. I see it now, laying it down, and I know that I need you. I run to the Father, I fall into grace, done with the hiding, a reason to wait. My heart needs a surgeon, my soul needs a friend, so I run to the Father. You saw my condition, had a plan from the start. Your son for redemption, the price for my heart. And I don't have a context for that kind of love. I don't understand, I can't comprehend. All I know is I need you. I run to the Father, I fall into grace. I'm done with the hiding, no reason to wait. My heart needs a surgeon, my soul needs a friend, so I run to the Father again and again and again and again. Pull me a little closer, take me a little deeper. I want to know your heart, I want to know your heart. Cause your love is so much sweeter than anything I've tasted. I want to know your heart, I want to know your heart. So pull me a little closer, take me. His blood atoned. Well, final breath and it was finished. But not the end we could have known. For the earth began to shake and the veil was torn. What sacrifice was made as the heavens rolled. Oh, hail King Jesus. deserve the highest praise. It's all for you, it's all for you. My King of Kings, the only one who is worthy, the only one who can save me. Oh, you alone can rescue. I'm in awe of you, Jesus. I'm so in awe of you, Jesus.
Trust in the Lord with all of your heart and lean not in your own understanding. Trust in the Lord with all of your heart and lean not on your own understanding. Father, we pray that that would be our prayer this week. That you would teach us to come to you afresh. That you would teach us and woo us to give to you our hearts. And to trust you with them. And then we ask you, Lord, what do you have for us? What do you have for us? At this time and in this place, in this city, in these circumstances, what do you have for us? And we invite you to speak. And then would you give us the humble courage to respond? We pray this in your name. Amen. Can I encourage you this week, as Kathleen has so rightly put, that we need to soak in these words to establish that sense of humble surrender before God, to establish that sense of letting go of places where our trust is in other things. We need to soak in this. This is a process. It's not a sort of one-hit moment. And so can I be encouraging you to just take a verse or two out of Proverbs chapter 3. Just sit in it. Even if it's just trust in the Lord with all of your heart. Trust in the Lord with all of your heart. Trust in the Lord with all of your heart. Be saying this over and over again, soaking in it, stewing in it, watching what the Spirit of God does in your heart as we're saying this throughout the day. And then just be journaling down what you think God might be saying to you. Remember to be joining us if you're new to Vintage at 12:30 today. We've got our Zoom, new to Vintage Zoom. But before that, let me pray a blessing over us. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look kindly upon you and fill you with his peace and his presence, his love and his joy. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you. Amen and amen.
'cause the great I am speaks over me. And I am what I am, 'cause the great I am said he speaks over me. And what you say is true, say, I am what I am, 'cause the great I am said he speaks over me.
Yes, he does.
And his word is true. Say, I am what I am, 'cause the great I am speaks over me.
Yes, he does. Yes, he does. Yes, he does.
And I am what I am, 'cause the great I am said he speaks over me.
Yes, he does. Yes, he does.
Calls me. Say, I am what I am, 'cause the great I am said he speaks all.
Hear the sound of the wind, let the rain.